welcome to the Gilbert House Fellowship, a virtual gathering of believers seeking to better understand the Word of God, with your hosts, Derek and Sharon Gilbert, and Sam T. Dachson. From the heart of the beautiful Missouri Ozarks, greetings and welcome to the Gilbert House Fellowship. This is the Old Testament study for Sunday, August 27th, 2017. I'm Derek Gilbert.
I'm Sharon Gilbert. Honey, I'm so proud of you. You knew the date.
I wrote it down.
Oh, you're good. You're so brilliant. Oh, well, we're back. Believe it or not, it's been 2 weeks since we've been here because we were up in Boise, Idaho. Almost didn't make it.
Yeah, that was an adventure. If you followed us on Facebook, you know that what should have been about an 8-hour trip took 18 hours. We missed a connecting flight in Denver because our plane from Springfield was delayed, didn't have the backup oxygen. I would rather have had the backup oxygen. And
you never know when you're going to need that backup oxygen.
Yeah.
Go to. Love it.
So we, after an hour of searching and then some prayer with Dr. Michael Lake, who was on our same flight, he lives near us in the Ozarks. We were told, well, we can get you to Bozeman, Montana. That's only 7 hours drive away. We're not doing that.
No, we figured Steve Quayle preferred that we stay out of Bozeman.
Yeah, yeah.
Get out, Gilbert.
Yeah. Okay, but you're going to
Steve's a friend, so that's why we can joke about that.
They eventually, and they searched because everybody, apparently, in North America was trying to get to Boise because Idaho was a great spot to view the eclipse on Monday.
In fact, Smith's Ferry, where we did go to observe the eclipse, was one of the best, if not the very best, spots in the nation to observe it.
Yeah, we were directly underneath the total eclipse of the sun.
Yeah.
And so we got to see the ring of fire around the moon, which was spectacular. In fact, we got decent audio. It's not, you know, professional quality equipment. I got it with my iPhone in 4K video mode, but was able to dial down the exposure to the point where you could see the ring around the moon. And we posted that on our Sci Friday broadcast for this past week.
Yeah, it was neat. It was so neat.
Yeah, that was really, really fantastic. So anyway, of course, to hear the Watchman Conference was wonderful. A great gathering of people. We get the chance to see Carl Gallup's. We were pretty busy during the rest of the conference, so we didn't get to see, I think, any of the other presenters, maybe a snippet of one or two. But we'll watch those on Vimeo.
And, I got to see yours.
Well, and I'm glad because it inspires me.
So good. So good. But it was great fellowship. Yeah. And one of my favorite things about those conferences, and it's not just here, the Watchman, it's all the conferences to which we go, is that you see people who attend more than one and they've made friendships.
Right.
And they rekindle these friendships, and you'll see knots of people who are embracing and talking and sharing and iron sharpening iron. It's wonderful.
Right.
The body of Christ, yes, we can virtually gather together just as we are now, right now, but being in the same room with each other, there's no substitution for that.
Right. And that's why we've said before that we don't intend for this virtual fellowship to be a replacement for a body of believers, a church.
It is the only church for some.
Yeah, that's true. And that's why we started this, to go through the Bible verse by verse and try to exegete to the best of our ability. And we don't pretend to be scholars, but at least, you know, try to read deeper than most of us have gotten in our churches before. We're blessed in that we essentially do church almost every day.
We're almost 24/7, 365. We're doing some sort of church or ministry.
Right.
And so we're constantly, you know, trying to learn.
Mm-hmm. And it's...
yeah, we do a lot of consuming and we'll just vomit it out for you. And they're going,
It comes out. Yeah, I can't unsee that image in my head. That's what results in the books and the video projects that we do and the presentations and so forth. That's one of the things that I find really motivating. You know, okay, you have to get up in front of a big group of people and sound like you know what you're talking about. So that really focuses your mind. So I forget who said this. I think it was somebody who'd been condemned by the King of England back in the day and said, you know, the prospect of one's imminent death has a wonderful focusing effect on the mind or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not quite the same thing, but it's similar. Knowing that you're going to stand in front of 400 people and then who knows how many mm-hmm. more watching a streaming video to focus the mind and, you know, make sure that you got your stuff together.
Well, in your case also, you have to produce a news update 4 days a week, and then we do Sci-Friday on the fifth day of that week. But you're also writing articles for the magazine every month. I mean, and many of you, it's exciting when you see a book project released.
Yeah.
But behind the release of that book project is over a year's worth of work, usually.
It's funny. Somebody posted a comment, and I forget where I even saw this, but it was either referring to my most recent book or I think maybe it was mine, and something about, books, easy money. Like, oh, if only you knew. It's one of those things where you don't even feel like responding. Yeah, it's just laugh. It's like, if you only knew.
If you only knew how little, you know, per hour the person is actually earning from that book. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's why, you know, people say, did you watch this on TV? You know, people send video links to YouTube. You got to watch this video. It's like, well, I'd love to, but we don't have time
for that two-hour video. Sorry.
I haven't watched a single Cubs game so far this year.
And, you know, honestly, if you had time, you would be watching those Cubs games.
Probably.
I mean, because you have to relax.
Yeah.
You do. And so
that's where fantasy baseball comes in. It's sort of my substitute for that. And we'll get this week's Heiser reference, ding, 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 of the week out of the way early. So
Grumpy
far,
Cats?
Yes, we're in the final day of our week. It's the Ozark Ramblers, that's my team, against the Grumpy Cats, which is Mike Heiser's team. And so far, it's the Ozark Ramblers ahead 9-6.
Oh!
Yeah. So it's going to be tight because there are a number of categories. We're really close. So it would be a little less close if we were so busy on Monday this week getting ready to go to the Eclipse that I forgot to take two of my starting pitchers off the bench, and one of them threw a no-hitter, which would have done wonders in the pitching categories. Mm-hmm. So if I lose it this week, it's my own fault for being a bad manager.
Oh, well, honey.
But it's, you know, again, it's relaxation.
Cute, it's
not stress. Well, certainly we don't have the kind of stress that King Hezekiah had waking up one day and finding the army of Assyria at his gates.
Oh, that's so true.
That was where we'll start this morning after we open with a word of prayer. Father, thank you for this day. And Lord, just help us to keep things in perspective that, as Paul wrote, the trials and tribulations that we face in this world today, and we can laugh and joke about some of the minor things we encountered, you know, the 18-hour trip to Boise. Well, it's not, we were going to be with friends and among friends, and there are people who have arduous journeys because they are fleeing the destruction of their homes right now. The hurricane, now Tropical Storm Harvey, that is devastating the Gulf Coast of the United States. I think of people in the Middle East, in the war-torn regions of Syria and Iraq, Libya, whose lives have been irrevocably changed because of the policies of people living on the other side of the planet who have no concern for their lives or the lives of their children or grandchildren. Those are people who know distress, who know trouble. And Lord, we just lift them up in prayer and ask that you would reveal yourself through the trials that they are enduring right now. Father, we have friends in the path of the hurricane. We've seen reports from some of them. And Lord, we just ask that you would moderate the influence of this storm. It is dropping an incredible amount of rain on the Houston area right now, and will likely track eventually to the north and east and leave flooding and devastation in its wake. Father, we just pray for those first responders who the people in that region depend on to keep them safe and to help dig out after an event like this. We pray that you would keep them safe from the effects of the storm. Lord, we ask as we study today, again, to keep our lives in perspective and to know, as Paul wrote, that the troubles, the trials that we suffer now are as nothing compared to the glory that is to come if we just put our trust in you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And while you were praying, every device in the house was reminding us that we're supposed to be recording Gilbert
Heights
Fellowship.
That's right, yes. Yeah. Well, good thing. We're smarter than the iPads. Yes.
Winning.
Yes. So today we'll be in 2 Kings, Psalms, and then back to the book of Isaiah, where we left off last week. And we'll be picking up the story that we had been reading in Isaiah last week as the Assyrians have surrounded Jerusalem after essentially laying waste to pretty much the rest of the kingdom of Judah. 2 Kings 19, beginning at verse 1, as soon as King Hezekiah heard it, and what he heard, of course, was the report from the Rabshakeh, which is the military leader or advisor, spokesperson for the king of Assyria, basically saying, surrender or die. As soon as King Hezekiah heard it, he tore his clothes and covered himself with sackcloth and went into the house of Yahweh. And he sent Eliakim, who was over the household, and Shebna, the secretary, and the senior priests, covered with sackcloth, to the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amoz. They said to him, thus says Hezekiah, this is a day of distress, of rebuke, and of disgrace. Children have come to the point of birth, and there is no strength to bring them forth. It may be that Yahweh your God heard all the words of the Rabshakeh, whom his master the king of Assyria has sent to mock the living God, and will rebuke the words that Yahweh your God has heard. Therefore, lift up your prayer for the remnant that is left. Sounds almost like a prayer that we could be praying today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So true.
When the servants of King Hezekiah came to Isaiah, Isaiah said to them, say to your master, thus says Yahweh, do not be afraid because of the words that you have heard, with which the servants of the king of Assyria have reviled me. Behold, I will put a spirit in him, so that he shall hear a rumor and return to his own land, and I will make him fall by the sword in his own land. The Rabshakeh returned and found the king of Assyria fighting against Libna, for he heard that the king had left Lachish. Now, Lachish was a fortified city in southern Israel, one of the strongest of the fortified cities in the kingdom of Judah. Sennacherib had, in fact, they found the remnants of the siege ramp that Sennacherib's troops put up against the walls of Lachish. I mean, this was serious, serious business. Libna, another city, obviously, in southern Israel, in Judah. Now, the king had heard concerning Tirhakah, king of Cush. Behold, he has set out to fight against you. Now, Tirhakah was... This was during a period of history when Egypt was under the control of Nubian kings. Tirhakah was one of the Nubian pharaohs who was in control of Egypt, and Judah was essentially a client state of Egypt at this point in history. I mean, you know, we read the Bible and we tend to think that, you know, these were, you know, Judah and Israel were, you know, powerful, independent polities. And really, after the time of Solomon, that really wasn't quite true. Israel had the northern kingdom had a period of power during the reign of Jeroboam II, who was a descendant of Ahab. But no, Judah was kind of dependent on...
They were a protectorate.
Yeah, Egypt not wanting to just come in and lay it waste. And they paid protection money. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So anyway, Tirhakah came up to the north to fight at the request of Hezekiah. Came out to fight against you. So he sent messengers again to Hezekiah, saying, thus shall you speak to Hezekiah, king of Judah. Do not let your God in whom you trust deceive you by promising that Jerusalem will not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. Behold, and again, this is a message from the Rabshakeh, not from Isaiah.
Right.
Behold, you have heard what the kings of Assyria have done to all lands, devoting them to destruction. And they had.
Mm-hmm.
And shall you be delivered? Have the gods of the nations delivered them, the nations that my fathers destroyed? Gozan, Haran, Rizeph, and the people of Eden who were in Telassar? And to be honest, we don't know where most of those were, except for Haran, which is in southern Turkey, northern Syria, the city of a moon god, where Abraham came from. Where is the king of Hamath, the king of Arpad, the king of the city of Sepharvaim? Hamath and Arpad were both in modern-day Syria. Sepharvaim, they think, is the city of Sippar in...
That makes sense.
What is now Iraq. The king of Hena or the king of Iva. Hezekiah received the letter from the hand of the messengers and read it. And Hezekiah went up to the house of Yahweh and spread it before Yahweh. And Hezekiah prayed before Yahweh and said, O Yahweh, the God of Israel, enthroned above the cherubim... That would be above the cherubim and the Ark of the Covenant. But... clearly, cherubim are throne guarding it. So even in the throne of God in heaven, the cherubim would be there. You are the God, you alone, of all the kingdoms of the earth. You have made heaven and earth. Incline your ear, O Yahweh, and hear. Open your eyes, O Yahweh, and see, and hear the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to mock the living God. Truly, O Yahweh, the kings of Assyria have laid waste the nations and their lands, and have cast their gods into the fire. For they were not gods, but the work of men's hands, wood and stone. Therefore they were destroyed. Now that's not to say that the entities behind those idols aren't real.
Right.
It's just that the entity behind Assyria was ascendant at this point.
There is no innate power within the idol itself.
That's correct, right. It just gives locality to the spirit.
It's like destroying a bunch of televisions.
Yeah, and saying that we've now destroyed all of the shows that were coming through the television.
Right.
Yeah, oh, hey, that's a good analogy. I like that.
Thanks, honey.
Now save that.
Peyton Pending.
Trademarked. So now, O Yahweh, our God, save us, please, from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you, O Yahweh, are God alone. Then Isaiah, the son of Amoz, sent to Hezekiah, saying, thus says Yahweh, the God of Israel, your prayer to me about Sennacherib, king of Assyria, I have heard. This is the word that Yahweh has spoken concerning him. She despises you, she scorns you, the virgin daughter of Zion. She wags her head behind you, the daughter of Jerusalem. Whom have you mocked and reviled? Against whom have you raised your voice and lifted your eyes to the heights? Against the Holy One of Israel. By your messengers you have mocked the Lord, and you have said, with my many chariots I have gone up the heights of the mountains. In the far recesses of Lebanon I felled its tall cedars, its choicest cypresses. I entered its farthest lodging place, its most fruitful forest. I dug wells and drank foreign waters, and I dried up with the sole of my foot all the streams of Egypt. Have you not heard that I determined it long ago? This is God now mocking the king of Assyria for his pride. Have you not heard that I determined it long ago? I planned from days of old what now I bring to pass, that you should turn fortified cities into heaps of ruins, while their inhabitants, shorn of strength, are dismayed and confounded, and have become like plants of the field and like tender grass, like grass on the housetops, blighted before it is grown. But I know you're sitting down, and you're going out and coming in, and you're raging against me. Because you have raged against me, and your complacency has come into my ears, I will put my hook in your nose and my bit in your mouth, and I will turn you back on the way by which you came. And this shall be the sign for you. This year eat what grows of itself, and in the second year what springs of the same. Then in the third year sow and reap and plant vineyards and eat their fruit. And the surviving remnant of the house of Judah shall again take root downward and bear fruit upward. For out of Jerusalem shall go a remnant, and out of Mount Zion a band of survivors. The zeal of Yahweh will do this. Therefore, thus says Yahweh concerning the king of Assyria, he shall not come into this city, or shoot an arrow there, or come before it with a shield, or cast up a siege mound against it. By the way that he came, by the same he shall return, and he shall not come into this city, declares Yahweh. For I will defend this city to save it for my own sake, and for the sake of my servant David. And that night, the angel of Yahweh went out and struck down 185,000 in the camp of the Assyrians. That's a Christophany, the angel of Yahweh.
I know, this is just chilling.
Yes. And when people arose early in the morning, behold, these were all dead bodies. Then Sennacherib, king of Assyria, departed and went home and lived at Nineveh. And as he was worshiping in the house of Nisroch, his god, and interestingly, Nisroch is not a deity that is known outside the Bible. So this could be a something that was transliterated into Hebrew incorrectly, or it could be that Sennacherib had a personal god that was not well known in the ancient world.
It's an eagle-headed human figure.
Oh. An eagle-headed human figure. That would be one of the... That would be one of the Apkallu.
Exactly.
That was one of the three forms of the Apkallu, the watchers.
Yes.
Wow. Huh. Okay.
I had to mark that one.
Yeah. So 2 Kings 19:37. Boy, that's interesting.
So write down Nisroch.
2 King 19:37, Nisroch. Huh. Possibly the name of one of the... Apkallu, yeah. And as he was worshiping in the house of Nisroch, his god, Adrammelech and Sharezer, his sons, struck him down with the sword, and escaped into the land of Ararat. That would be north towards Armenia, the kingdom of Urartu. Mm-hmm. And Esarhaddon, his son, reigned in his place.
I guess the Abkhali wasn't very powerful.
I guess not. Well, you know, it's hard to do much when you're in chains and gloomy darkness. Although he might not have been one of those, not all of the watchers.
No, that's true.
Because there were watchers who descended in the days of Nebuchadnezzar.
Exactly. Now we're going to go to Psalm 46. Because we do this chronologically, so that's why we bounce around a bit. To the choir master of the sons of Korah, according to Alamoth, a song. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. And that is indeed what he was to Hezekiah.
And by the way, Alamoth is not a name. It is a musical term. And according to 1 Corinthians 15:20, it's related to harps.
Oh, how cool.
Yeah.
Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling.
And this is
sort of language sounds sort of like the monster of the deep who's churning up the waters.
Exactly what I was going to say. And we see that in a couple of the Psalms here that we'll be reading today. The sea, the ocean, in the ancient Near East, not just Israel, but in Mesopotamia as well. The Canaanites, too, viewed it as representation of primordial chaos. The Egyptians, even so.
Selah.
Yeah.
There is a river, this is verse 4, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. Mm. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. And that is indeed how things are going to go. Eventually, all of this will burn up, and a brand new heaven and earth will be created. Mm-hmm. Verse 7, the Lord Yahweh of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress, Selah. Come, behold the works of Yahweh, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Yahweh of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress, Selah. You know, that's short enough. You could memorize that. That is a very comforting psalm.
Yeah. And the reason we read these in chronological order is because it adds context to these psalms, especially when we're reading them alongside the events that probably inspired them. So think about this, and people in the temple or in the courts of the temple singing something like this with the 185,000 men of the Assyrian army, the baddest army in the Near East, probably in the entire world at that time, right outside your walls.
Yeah.
And seeing the signal fires from the other cities of Judah, from the hills, you know, like a Lord of the Rings type thing. Lachish has fallen. Libna has fallen. You know,
you're next.
Yeah. Bethel has fallen. And knowing that years before, the northern kingdom, Samaria, had been destroyed, and the people of Israel, we know what happened to them. You know, all of the northern tribes have been carried off into a foreign land, away from the land of Yahweh, because they understood. You know, today in our modern world, we don't get this context or this understanding of holy ground, because we move all over the place. People used to laugh that they'd have a separate address book just for Sharon and me because we moved so frequently. But in Israel and in the ancient world, they understood this. The example of Naaman, who was the army commander for the king of Syria, who got healed by the prophet Elisha and carried a donkey load of dirt from Israel back home with him, because that was the land of Yahweh. And to be separated from the land and carried off to a foreign David, in one of his psalms, laments that if he gets driven out of Israel, will he be able to worship Yahweh in a foreign land that is not God's holy ground?
So
think about that, and think about the panic that must have been in the hearts of, or the dismay. I mean, Hezekiah, the king, tearing his clothes and covering himself with dirt and prostrating himself before the altar. And, you know, Yahweh, What are we going to do? Why is this happening to us?
Yes. Well, to bring it back around to the books I write, think of the plot that I've got, that there's something inside that stone that Warren brings mm-hmm. back with him. That stone came from Mount Hermon.
Right.
He's essentially
right.
bringing back land, property that has been given over to a spirit.
Yes.
Into England.
It's the same concept, although reversed, as in Bram Stoker's Dracula.
Exactly.
And why Dracula always has to take the dirt from his homeland. Right.
Exactly.
So it's the same sort of concept. Mm-hmm. In our modern world, we've been kind of severed from that because we don't seem to have that, or we don't have that understanding. Oh, that's a simple concept back in the day. You know, primitive man, they didn't know it. They worshiped blocks of wood and stone. No, they had a more clear understanding of the nature of the spirit realm than we do.
And think about it. If you think of these blocks of wood and stone as receptors, as televisions,
yeah,
then...
I like
you
that.
Know, well, as long as they are there and functionable, then this entity can still gain access.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they have to be thoroughly destroyed.
Right. The high places had to be torn down.
Yes.
Yeah, that's a really good point. That's a good point. Well, and one other thing, that in verse 11, and we saw it earlier in that that psalm, it's a phrase that pops up over and over in the Old Testament, Lord of hosts, Lord of hosts, Lord of hosts. I think we've heard it in church so often, we don't really understand what it means. In Hebrew, sometimes you hear it as Lord Sabaoth.
Mm-hmm.
But Yahweh Sabaoth, the Hebrew, means Yahweh of armies.
Yes.
It basically means he is the commander in chief of
yes.
the heavenly army.
Yes.
He is a military commander. Now, we're not saying that we as Christians, you know, should be onward Christian soldiers. Let's go take over the world. That's not what Jesus commanded us to do. But there's a day coming when he does come back, the angel of Yahweh, Jesus, in that capacity, the captain of the host of Yahweh's host. And he will be at the head of the Sabaoth, mm-hmm. the heavenly army.
Yes.
So, I got an email yesterday, which I looked at it, glanced at it, looked at the guy's website, and then hit, control block delete. It trying to make the case, and you see this from time to time among more progressive Christians, that the God of the Old Testament is not Jesus, because Jesus is kind and loving and accepting, and it's,
Have you read the Bible?
They did, but they didn't like it, and that's why they're trying to edit the Bible.
Oh.
So they don't like the God, and frankly, this is, you can really get into some anti-Semitic stuff when you start going down that path. Jesus was the consummate Jew, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, we are Christians, but we need as Christians to understand that he is the Messiah because he fulfilled the law.
Yeah.
He was the consummate Jew.
Exactly.
Now, in doing so, he became our high priest, and because no high priest prior to Jesus, who was from the tribe of Judah, ever came from Judah. They all came from Levi. Mm-hmm. Change in the priesthood, there is necessarily a change in the law as well. That's Hebrews 7.
Mm-hmm.
So we are not bound by the law and the feasts of Yahweh and the dietary laws and so forth. If you want to keep those, that's fine, but we are not obligated. That's not how we're judged.
Right.
That was the shadow of the substance that was to come, which is Christ.
It's not core doctrine.
Exactly. But this fella, and there are some out there who are preaching and teaching this, they like this idea of a lovey, cuddly, accepting Jesus, and they don't like the idea of the warrior God, which is how he's described in the Old Testament. And we'll say things like the God of the Jews, but that is God.
Mm-hmm.
There is no God of the Jews versus Jesus. It's one and the same. To say that is heresy.
Mm-hmm.
To say that they're separate and somehow the Old Testament we should ignore and we should only look mm-hmm. at the New Testament. I'm sorry, but that's heresy.
Yes. Well, the TV show Preacher is just filled with heresy. Please don't watch that. It'll drive you crazy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
Jesus is shown as having sex with Mary Magdalene.
Oh, really?
Yes, that was the most recent program.
Oh, great. Yeah, I watched one of those shows first up because I was curious.
Yep, stamped it stupid and moved on.
Stamped it stupid and moved on. Yeah, exactly. So anyway, there is a lot of stupid out
mm-hmm.
there. And unfortunately, it's lies from the enemy.
It's blasphemous.
And yes, and we don't use blasphemy and heresy correctly often enough in the modern world. There are times we'll see, in fact, we were talking about this morning, a ministry that we support was labeled heretical just because somebody disagrees with the doctrine and, you know, their approach toward eschatology.
Yeah.
Well, come on. Heresy is when you're preaching a different salvation and a different God, a different Jesus.
Yes.
And they're not. They just have a different interpretation of eschatology than...
Yeah.
Anyway, that's not heresy. Heresy is when you're trying to change who God is. What do you do with Jesus? That's how you define heresy. How do you define salvation? Grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone.
Amen.
You get away from that, you're getting...
That is it alone.
You're getting into heresy if you go away from that. So anyway, that's a pretty good rabbit trail there. All right.
But worth it, I think.
I think so, too. So let's move on to Psalm 80. And again, in the context of what's going on outside the walls of Jerusalem. To the choir master, according to Lilies, a testimony of Asaph, a psalm. Give ear, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock. You who are enthroned above the cherubim, shine forth. Again, the Ark of the Covenant, not a radio to talk from God. That's his throne on earth. Now, by this point in history, I think there's a reference to the Ark in Josiah's day. So the Ark may still have been with Israel in this time, but I think it was hidden before Nebuchadnezzar destroyed. Mm-hmm. So I think that was the last reference that we see of the Ark. So anyway, enthroned above the cherubim, shine forth. Before Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh, stir up your might and come to save us. The psalm is directed at the northern tribes, basically. Ephraim, Manasseh. Ephraim, a representation of the northern tribes. Restore to us, O God. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine that we may be saved. O Yahweh of hosts. Yahweh Sabaoth.
Mm-hmm.
How long will you be angry with your people's prayers? You have fed them with the bread of tears and given them tears to drink in full measure. You make us an object of contention for our neighbors. And our enemies laugh among themselves. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your face shine that we may be saved. You brought a vine out of Egypt. You drove out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it. It took deep root and filled the land. The mountains were covered with its shade, the mighty cedars with its branches. In other words, you know, we cleared out Canaan, planted Israel there, and spread out as far as the mighty cedars, which is Lebanon. And, you know, Hermon.
Mm-hmm.
It sent out its branches to the sea and its shoots to the river being a reference to the Euphrates.
Yes.
Why then have you broken down its walls so that all who pass along the way pluck its fruit? The boar from the forest ravages it, of course, the boar being an unclean animal, and all that move in the field feed on it. Turn again, O God of hosts. Look down from heaven and see. Have regard for this vine, the stock that your right hand planted, and for the sun whom you made strong for yourself. They have burned it with fire. They have cut it down. May they perish at the rebuke of your face. But let your hand be on the man of your right hand, the son of man whom you have made strong for yourself. Now, are they... it's not capitalized there, so I don't think they're referring to the son of man, which is a phrase that Jesus used to describe himself. It's also one used by Daniel in his vision of the divine council throne room, one like the Son of Man with the Ancient of Days. Anyway, verse 17 again, but let your hand be on the man of your right hand, the Son of Man, whom you have made strong for yourself. Then we shall not turn back from you. Give us life, and we will call upon your name. Restore us, O Yahweh of hosts. Let your face shine that we may be saved.
Now we're going to go to Psalm 135. Praise Yahweh. Praise the name of the Lord Yahweh. Give praise, O servants of Yahweh, who stand in the house of Yahweh in the courts of the house of our God. Praise Yahweh, for Yahweh is good. Sing to his name, for it is pleasant. And anytime you see Lord capitalized, that's when we say Yahweh, because that's what it means.
Mm-hmm.
For Yahweh has chosen Jacob for himself, Israel as his possession.
And this is divine counsel reference, Deuteronomy 32:8-9, when God divided the nations, when he set the borders of the peoples, he numbered them according to the number of the sons of God. But Israel was his own allotted heritage. Israel,
and listen
his
to
people.
This. For I know that Yahweh is great and that our Lord is above all small g gods.
Right.
divine counsel.
Exactly. Yep.
Whatever Yahweh pleases, he does in heaven and on earth, in the seas and all deeps.
And this is, again, getting back to what you referenced in Psalm 46 mm-hmm. with the language of the deeps and the chaos and the, you know.
He it is who makes the clouds rise at the end of the earth, who makes lightnings for the rain and brings forth the wind from the storehouses. Storm God language.
Yep.
He it was who struck down the firstborn of Egypt, both of man and of beast, who in your midst, O Egypt, sent signs and wonders against Pharaoh and all his servants, who struck down many nations and killed mighty kings, Sihon, king of the Amorites, and Og, king of Bashan, and all the kingdoms of Canaan, and gave their land as a heritage to his people, Israel. In other words, I'm stronger than all you small g gods.
Exactly.
Your name, O Yahweh, endures forever. Your renown, O Yahweh, throughout all ages. For Yahweh will vindicate his people and have compassion on his servants. The idols of the nations are silver and gold, the work of human hands. Again, televisions. They have mouths but do not speak. They have eyes but do not see. They have ears, but do not hear, nor is there any breath in their mouths. Those who make them become like them. I'm going to repeat that. Those who make them become like them. So do all who trust in them. In other words, small g gods have no power.
Right.
Don't be a fool. O house of Israel, bless Yahweh. O house of Aaron, bless Yahweh. O house of Levi, bless Yahweh. You who fear Yahweh, bless Yahweh. Blessed be Yahweh from Zion. He who dwells in Jerusalem, praise Yahweh. That's a nice one. I like that one.
And we've said before, the reason we substitute Yahweh for the capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D in the Old Testament is not because we're into sacred name.
No,
stuff.
Not at all. It's just that that's what they put in here. It's not Adonai.
Right.
It's not Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
It's not El Shaddai.
Right.
It's Yahweh. It's the name that he gave to Moses.
Exactly. And it makes it more personal, it seems. More immediate. You know, the Lord seems kind of almost generic.
Yeah, it does. And then in our English language, sadly, it's almost become a proper name.
Yeah, yeah. Which is what happened to Baal in the Old Testament, or Baal.
Yes.
Yeah, you scholars, I do know how to pronounce it. It was his title, and we'll see in the, in fact, we saw it in the reference last week to Bel, the god of the Mesopotamians, Babylonians. Bel was the title of Marduk, and that's all it means, is Lord. And when you think about it, that's really the arrogance of these small g gods in convincing their followers, whether it's Hadad, the storm god, who became known as Baal, or Marduk, who became known as Bel, to convince their followers to call them Lord instead of the one true capital L Lord, which is Yahweh. But again, to differentiate that while we're reading it out loud, we just substitute Yahweh, and that's why we do it. Again, we're not into sacred name stuff. That's again, getting cult-like. If you don't use the right name, he won't know who you're praying to.
No. I think he knows. He knows what's in my heart.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, he created all the languages of the earth, so I'm pretty sure he can speak them all and understand them all. Isaiah 50, thus says Yahweh, where is your mother's certificate of divorce with which I sent her away? Or which of my creditors is it to whom I have sold you? Behold, for your iniquities you were sold. And this, by the way, is Yahweh's message to the exiles of Israel, to just let them know that their punishment, while they are being punished for their own misdeeds, it's only temporary. Okay. It's not a permanent separation. Or which of my creditors is it to whom I have sold you? Behold, for your iniquities you were sold, and for your transgressions your mother was sent away. Why, when I came, was there no man? Why, when I called, was there no one to answer? Is my hand shortened that it cannot redeem? Or have I no power to deliver? Behold, by my rebuke, I dry up the sea.
In other words, I conquer chaos. Exactly.
Right. Leviathan, yes, Rahab, etc. I make the rivers a desert.
By the way, the gods also existed in the rivers.
Yes.
So the salt water and the fresh water both had their own gods.
In Canaanite cosmology, and of course they adapted the story and accredited the victory to Baal. Baal defeated Yam, which was called Prince Yam, the god of the sea, and Judge Nahar, which is river. So basically, like Yahweh and the angel of Yahweh, you know, the two powers in heaven, mm-hmm. you had this sort of divine entity with a like a vice regent
right.
sort of thing going on there as well.
Right.
By my rebuke, I dry up the sea. I make the rivers a desert. Their fish stink for lack of water and die of thirst. I clothe the heavens with blackness and make sackcloth their covering.
In other words, I blot out
yes.
all of these heavenly beings.
Right.
Now, we're not saying that you should worship or these balls of fire in the sky and the planets are actually gods.
Right.
But they represent gods within the divine assembly. And I always call it in my novels, the infernal assembly.
Right. That makes more sense and is accurate,
too. The infernal realm.
Mm-hmm. Isaiah 50, verse 4, the Lord God has given me the tongue of those who are taught. And in that case, the Lord Yahweh, it's the Lord, then capital G-O-D. So the Lord Yahweh has given me the tongue of those who are taught that I may know how to sustain with a word him who is weary.
With a word. Isn't that wonderful?
There are days when I feel like that's my only marketable skill.
Of course, when you think of one of the names of Christ Jesus is Logos, he is the word.
He is the word, yes. The Lord Yahweh has given me the tongue of those who are taught, that I may know how to sustain with a word him who is weary. Morning by morning he awakens. He awakens my ear to hear as those who are taught. The Lord Yahweh has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I turned not backward. I gave my back to those who strike, and my cheeks to those who pull out the beard.
This is prophetic language.
Yeah. Yes, messianic.
Exactly.
I hid not my face from disgrace and spitting. But the Lord Yahweh helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who is my adversary? Let him come near to me. Behold, the Lord Yahweh helps me. Who will declare me guilty? Behold, all of them will wear out like a garment. The moth will eat them up. Who among you fears Yahweh and obeys the voice of his servant? Let him who walks in darkness and has no light trust in the name of Yahweh and rely on his God. Behold, all you who kindle a fire, who equip yourselves with burning torches, walk by the light of your fire and by the torches that you have kindled. This you have from my hand. You shall lie down in torment.
Ooh. Isaiah 51, back to Isaiah. Listen to me, you who pursue righteousness, you who seek Yahweh. Look to the rock from which you were hewn and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham your father and to Sarah who bore you, for he was but one when I called him, that I might bless him and multiply him. For the Yahweh comforts Zion. He comforts all her waste places and makes her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of Yahweh. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Give attention to me, my people, and give ear to me, my nation. Are we done, Sam? Sam just got up from his bed and he's walking out.
That's a 15-minute warning.
Back to verse 4. Give attention to me, my people, and give ear to me, my nation, for a law will go out from me. For teaching will go out from me, and I will set my justice for a light to the peoples. My righteousness draws near, my salvation has gone out, and my arms will judge the peoples. The coastlands hope for me, and for my arm they wait. That's so true. At the time that Isaiah wrote this, the nations that were under the rulership of small g gods, they didn't have the benefit of learning directly from Yahweh.
Mm-hmm. Right.
All they had was what those small g gods were telling them.
Mm-hmm.
They had a pack of lies. Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look at the earth beneath, for the heavens vanish like smoke. The earth will wear out like a garment, and they who dwell in it will die in like manner, or die like gnats.
Hmm.
That's interesting. SWAT. Huh. But my salvation will be forever, and my righteousness will never be dismayed. Listen to me, you who know righteousness, the people in whose heart is my law. Fear not the reproach of man, nor be dismayed at their revilings. Memorize those two lines.
Hmm.
Fear not the reproach of man, nor be dismayed at their revilings. Right in the margin, social media. For the moth will eat them up like a garment, and the worm will eat them like wool. But my righteousness will be forever, and my salvation to all generations. Awake, awake, put on strength, O arm of Yahweh. Awake as in days of old, the generations of long ago. Was it not you who cut Rahab in pieces?
Another reference.
Who pierced the dragon?
Another reference to the battle against the chaos dragon of pre-creation days. This is really intriguing. And by the way, this is something that we get into in the
There's more language. Forthcoming book. Let me finish it.
Yeah.
Was it not you who dried up the sea, the waters of the great deep, who made the depths of the sea a way for the redeemed to pass over?
It's a reference to the crossing of the Red Sea, but it's also in a symbolic form or a metaphorical sense, a way that God has defeated this chaos and redeemed humanity as a whole from, well, those who trust in him anyway, trust in Christ Jesus. Yeah.
Oh, I love that language.
Mm-hmm.
And the ransomed of Yahweh shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. And they shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. I am he who comforts you. Who are you that you are afraid of man who dies, of the son of man who is made like grass, and have forgotten the Lord Yahweh, your maker? This is in Elijah. Again, if you listen to Elijah over and over, you will memorize scripture. Seriously.
You're talking about the opera?
The oratorio.
The oratorio, yeah.
Yes, Mendelssohn's Elijah. It is all scripture. Every word of it is scripture. If you listen to that enough times, you will memorize large swaths of scripture, and you will get this amazing picture of God's salvation in the Old Testament. It is so cool.
Imagine, you know, the beauty of, not the rabbit trail here, of works created by men like Mendelssohn and Handel.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
What do you think they're creating now when they've got a...
That's the question.
Heavenly choir and heavenly orchestra to work with.
Yeah, I know. Oh. Back to verse 12. I am he who comforts you. Who are you that you are afraid of man who dies, of the son of man who is made like grass, and have forgotten Yahweh your maker, who stretched out the heavens and laid the foundations of the earth, and you fear continually all the day because of the wrath of the oppressor when he sets himself to destroy? And where is the wrath of the oppressor? He who is bowed down shall speedily be released. He shall not die and go down to the pit, neither shall his bread be lacking. I am Yahweh, your Lord, your God, who stirs up the sea. I've got this turned all the way down, and yet I heard that.
Hmm.
That little ding. I am Yahweh, your God, who stirs up the sea so that its waves roar. Yahweh of hosts is his name. I have put my words in your mouth and covered you in the shadow of my hand, establishing the heavens and laying the foundations of the earth and saying to Zion, you are my people. Wake yourself, wake yourself. Stand up, O Jerusalem, you who have drunk from the hand of Yahweh the cup of his wrath. Mm. This is prophetic language.
Mm-hmm.
Who have drunk to the dregs the bowl, the cup of staggering. Jerusalem will be a cup of trembling.
Yeah.
There is none to guide her among all the sons she has borne. There is none to take her by the hand among all the sons she has brought up. These two things have happened to you. Who will console you? Devastation and destruction, famine and sword. Who will comfort you? Let's see. How shall I comfort you is the alternate from the Masoretic text. Your sons have fainted. They lie at the head of every street like an antelope in a net. They are full of the wrath of Yahweh, the rebuke of your God. Therefore, hear this, you who are afflicted, who are drunk, but not with wine. Thus says Yahweh, thus says your Lord, Yahweh, your God who pleads the cause of his people. Behold, I have taken from your hand the cup of staggering, the bowl of my wrath you shall drink no more. And I will put it into the hand of your tormentors, who have said to you, again, will become a cup of trembling to the nations. This is the prophetic language that we see mm-hmm. echoed in the book of Revelation. Bow down that we may pass over. And you have made your back like the ground and like the street for them to pass over.
Isaiah 52. Awake, awake, put on your strength, O Zion. Put on your beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city, for there shall no more come into you the uncircumcised and the unclean. Again, this is prophetic. God has judged Jerusalem, but will redeem and restore it. Shake yourself from the dust and arise. Be seated, O Jerusalem. Loose the bonds from your neck, O captive daughter of Zion. For thus says Yahweh, you were sold for nothing, and you shall be redeemed without money. For thus says Yahweh, my people went down at the first into Egypt to sojourn there, and the Assyrian oppressed them for nothing. Now, therefore, what I have here, declares Yahweh, seeing that my people are taken away for nothing, their rulers wail, declares Yahweh, and continually all the day my name is despised. Therefore, my people shall know my name. Therefore, in that day, they shall know that it is I who speak. Here I am. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who publishes peace, who brings good news of happiness, who publishes salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. The voice of your watchmen, they lift up their voice. Together they sing for joy, for eye to eye they see the return of Yahweh to Zion. Break forth together into singing, your waste places of Jerusalem, for Yahweh has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. Yahweh has bared his holy arm before the eyes of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our God. Depart. Depart, go out from there. Excuse me. Depart. Depart, go out from there. Touch no unclean thing. Go out from the midst of her. Purify yourselves, you who bear the vessels of Yahweh. For you shall not go out in haste. And you shall not go in flight, for Yahweh will go before you, and the God of Israel will be your rear guard. Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which has not been told them, they see. That which they have not heard, they understand.
The word that is translated in verse 15 as sprinkle is alternately startle, which makes a little more sense in context. But this sounds like the way our Lord appeared at his first advent, so marred beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of the children of mankind.
Right. This is prophetic. We're talking about, and Isaiah 53 is a chapter that we talked about with the Messianic Rabbi Zev Porat when we were in Boise. And he confirms what we have heard elsewhere, that Isaiah 53 is a chapter in the Old Testament, the Tanakh, that...
52 or 53? 50,
we're about to, get into 53, but 52 begins with verse 13 there, my servant shall be... shall like wisely be high and lifted up as on the cross.
Yes, on the cross, exactly. Right.
And the rabbis will not teach Isaiah 53 because it is so clearly messianic and so clearly refers to Jesus of Nazareth that they will not teach this chapter.
And here it is. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of Yahweh been revealed? Again, that's also in Elijah. For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces, He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And Yahweh has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a lamb that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people, and they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of Yahweh to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of Yahweh shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Hmm. That is so clearly Yeshua HaMashiach.
Yes.
Jesus the Christ.
Mm-hmm. Poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors, yet he bore the sin of many.
Yes,
and
the makes thieves were on either side.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, it's clear this is why this is something that the rabbis in Israel today choose not to discuss, because it's difficult to explain this, and Psalm 22 as well. We didn't ask Zev about that. I have to do that at some point. Mm-hmm. Had the opportunity to interview him, and it's a very brief interview, which you can find at the Skywatch TV YouTube channel or skywatchtv.com. Just a 10-12 minute interview with Zev. Interesting fellow, born into a family of rabbis, lived in a village where all the men are rabbis.
Not just rabbis, they are part of his family is part of the Sanhedrin.
Yeah, the reconstituted Sanhedrin. Yes. So he was expected to continue in the family tradition as another rabbi, and he said, I just didn't feel it, so he rebelled, considered himself an atheist, but then through
online encouragement and witnessing.
Right, curiosity, seeking the truth, and then an American. He identified only as Todd, who witnessed to him for 4 years. He was finally led to Jesus Christ, and now he is witnessing and preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ in Tel Aviv, mm-hmm. which is not an easy thing to do, because I know we American evangelical Christians have a very favorable view of Israel, as we should. Again, they are God's allotted heritage, his inheritance. But the rabbis there consider Christianity a heretical sect that split off 2,000 years ago and has been, and sadly they're right in a lot of this, spent many, many years persecuting the Jews.
Yeah, so some did.
Some did. You know, as we talked with Joel Richardson a couple of years ago about his book, When a Jew Rules the World, mm-hmm. Even respected and, you know, honored Christians of the last, you know, 1,000 years, like Martin Luther, were very anti-Semitic. So it's understandable that the rabbis don't have a very favorable view of Jesus and of Christians in general. So he's walking a very tough road, but it's because those are his people. It's like Paul, who said that he would gladly go to you know, eternal torment if it meant that all of his people, the Jews, could be saved.
Yes.
But we're all responsible for our own decisions. So
that's the essence of free will.
Exactly. So anyway, yeah, Isaiah 53 is a really interesting chapter in the Bible, and it's one that is a powerful witnessing tool if you can get it into the hands of Jews. In fact, it was telling us how they managed to do it in...
Oh, it's so funny.
Oh, man. He says, apparently Chinese restaurants in Israel are very, very popular. And they're popular here in the United States, mm-hmm. too. We love Chinese food. And whenever there's a new Chinese restaurant that opens up, people will flock to it to check it out and, you know, be the first ones to sample it and tell their friends. So Zev happens to be married to a wonderful and very intelligent lady of Chinese descent. She's from Shanghai, mm-hmm. Lin. And so they had Isaiah 53 published, printed up in Chinese.
Yes.
And so they were handing out what people thought was a flyer or a menu for a new Chinese mm-hmm. restaurant. And it was Isaiah 53.
Oh, it was so wonderful. It was so wonderful. So wonderful.
And so they're reading this. It's like, by his stripes, we are healed. Wait a minute. What's this? What's this Christian stuff? No. This is in your Bible. This is from the prophet Isaiah. Oh, really?
By the way, Zev Perot, I think, is going to be coming back here in the United States. We're hoping to do another interview with him. But at the very least, we were talking with him and with Lynn about possibly meeting with him in Jerusalem next May.
Yes.
I'm bringing this up because we have 7 spots left.
Right.
That's it. If you want to go to Israel with us and with the Heisers, you need to reserve it now.
Yeah. No more time to delay. We're basically capping the tour at 100, which gives us basically 2 pretty much full tour buses.
Yeah, we're talking crammed full, right, but they're almost full, and it makes for a comfortable ride for everyone.
Right. 60-person buses leaves a few empty seats that we can, mm-hmm. you know, put, you know, cases of water and stuff on, you know.
Yeah, cameras.
Yeah, camera equipment and extra bags and whatnot. But, as Sharon said, that as of today, as we record this on August 27th, we are down to just 7 slots left for the Year 70 Tour of Israel, May 6th through 16th. A few extra days if you plan to take the extension and go to Petra.
By the way,
Jordan.
Derek and I are staying. We're going to go to Petra if we can get in there. So we we're in the extended part.
Right. Yeah. Seeing Petra is going to be fantastic. And if you want to think about that part of it too, I mean, that was the scene that Steven Spielberg used for the Indiana Jones movie with Sean Connery,
The Last Crusade.
Right. That's where they went to find the, and we're not really,
it was all fake.
Yeah. I know that was all fake on the inside. Yeah. We're not actually going to find the what do they call it? The Holy Grail inside.
No, that's not it.
But the kingdom of the Nabataeans, which was an Arab kingdom from about 3rd century BC until 2nd century AD or thereabouts, was carving that into the rock. That was phenomenal.
It's beautiful.
So beautiful. So it's once in a lifetime thing. But again, only 7 slots left. So don't delay. Well, some fascinating stuff today. And getting Isaiah 53 in there was just really amazing, especially just after having had the opportunity to discuss it with a messianic evangelist.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Father, we thank you for opening your word to us and giving us eyes to see what small portion of wisdom we have. Lord, we ask you to increase. Grant us wisdom and discernment, not that we can glory, you know, and magnify ourselves, but so that we can better understand your word and your will and better understand why friends and family members and colleagues and coworkers have ignored or rejected your word and your gospel. Give us words to speak when the opportunities present, Lord, that we may share the hope that we have in Christ with gentleness and respect. Father, we pray again for the safety of those, especially first responders in the path of the storm. We pray for your missionaries who are preaching the gospel to the ends of the earth, especially in the Middle East and China. Father, we pray, and Lord, we just ask that you would give them comfort and encouragement. We pray for the missionaries in the places of the world where the demons, the enemy, the principalities and powers are firmly entrenched. Lord, we know that this world is groaning and waiting for your soon return. We know that there are those under the throne calling to you. How long, O Lord? Father, we just pray that you would give us a spirit of desire to share this the good news of your gospel while we still draw breath. Time grows short, Lord, and we know that you would desire that none perish. But in your wisdom, you granted us all free will, including the free will to turn away from you, to turn our backs on you. And Lord, again, we just ask that you grant us the words to speak when we have the opportunity to share with those in our circle, our sphere of influence, that they might draw near to you and that your Holy Spirit may convict them and bring them into salvation. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Until next time, I'm Derek Gilbert.
I'm Sharon Gilbert. Bye-bye, everybody.
Thank you for joining us. We post a new Bible study each Sunday morning. Join the discussion at the Gilbert House Fellowship page on Facebook. Subscribe to our podcast feed and explore the archives online at gilberthouse.org.
Troublesome times are here, filling men's hearts with fear. Freedom we all hold dear, now is at stake. Humbling your hearts to